Okay, good morning friends. We are back with the second part of this video in which we will be talking about center state financial relations. I've introduced you with this initiative. So let's get directly started. The full topic is center state financial relation, and we're looking at it from in normal times as well as in emergency times. Okay, first of all, the articles which are concerned regarding center state financial relations are under Article 268 to 293. Now this is a very long description of center state relations, and economic and financial perspective make a very great bedrock of a nation. Hence Constitution has provided in-depth understanding of center state finance relations. Okay, now all these provisions are not for our purpose to understand, but we'll be understanding them from certain broad perspectives. Okay, say for example, the tax perspectives, non-tax perspective, grant in aid, and the borrowing powers. These are of our use, and now and then questions have been asked in prelims as well as mains in them. But before we start studying, friends, we have to understand one thing as to in what background these things are written. Say whenever you complete or study from any study material, one of the very key thing which is missing in most of the aspirants is they do not understand as to in what background those things are written, and why do we find such a recurrence of exceptions, why are there certain additional clauses. So understanding the background would certainly help you goes as to why these exceptions are made in this. Now let me take you to the background of when the center state financial relations were written. See, our constitution was written as a whole document in one go, say in around 48 to 50s. It is the background or the events at this time which influenced the mindset of our constitutional makers so as to design our center state financial relations. Now friends, go back to the history classes of yours and try to imagine the scenario at that time. What was our aspirations as a new nation? What were challenges we were facing? What we had projected as our dream? How we want to make our nations? And accordingly, everything at that time situation is widely speaking its importance, a role in these center state financial relations. Say for example, at that time we envisaged a state, a very strong center. So see, the taxing power, the important taxing powers, certain restrictions on state we find in our center state finance relations. At that time we were fighting various secessionist challenge in our country. So see, there would be certain clauses where we would be restricting states on certain accounts, that on these things you cannot tax, or these are the restrictions over you. Then we were planning to have a centralized planning. So now, and if you read these provisions, you will be finding a lot of inclusion of words like for the dam, say railways, defense, in electricity, and you will find lot of sub points which would be either taking away powers of state or would be giving more power to center in this context. Okay, also at that time we had given a tacit importance to federalism because of our cultural diversity. So we will be finding various provisions where interests of states are also taken care of. At the same time, you need to also understand that we also at that time did not wanted ki center becomes very very strong and monopolizes its power. Hence we have given certain protections to states. Now in this background we start studying our center state relations. Always keep this background in your brain so as to understand, then book would automatically start speaking to you. Okay, now we start the first concept, and is the tax proposals between center and state. Now friends, see, when we understand tax, make an image of your in your head as to what would a tax to a center and state means. See, to center and state, tax would mean two things. Say, who would be the one who would be who would be taxing that commodity. Say for example, income tax. So whether state would impose that income tax or center would impose. Okay, another one would be important aspect would be ki who will be using it. Okay, these are the primary classifications. So always have this thing in your head. Okay, now we understand the allocation part first. See, there have been union list, centers and concurrent list, and these are mentioned in a schedule 7 of our constitution. So that same list provides the taxation and allocates the various items of center and state. See, the state list contains 15 points, state list contains 20, concurrent list contains 3 points. So this fact you need not to remember, but you need to remember this point, ki the residuary power regarding taxation is with parliament, and as a result of this parliament has introduced now and then lot of taxes, say octroi tax, then it has also come out with wealth tax, gift taxes, but after the coming of GST all have been subsumed into one set of taxes. Now again go to the background. Now see, we have given 20 items in state list, but items given in state list or union list are a very broad or a very vaguely used word. Say for example, electricity, forest. Hence we cannot give absolute power to states to tax or apply tax on them. Okay, so hence the constitution come out with the certain restrictions ki on profession tax you cannot impose more than 2500 rupees. Now next point is very important. See, now certain taxes on goods state is forbid to do, say on export and import. Now imagine if these coastal states, if they are given absolute power of taxation, so they can harass center by taxing too much on them. Okay, and center would not be having an effective control over them. Okay, then there are interstate goods. If states are given their monopoly on this taxation, they will not let the hinterland states, which connect a lot of other states, would be having the monopoly and would be beneficiary from it. Okay, then there is another restriction ki even parliament exempt certain goods to be value good, then a state cannot do it. See, this is where the effective control or stronger center comes in play. Now again, see, electricity coming, this is a part of centralized planning. Okay, ki electricity which is given to center or used by railways will not be taxed. Okay, now again, this is a centralized planning, a planning concept. Again, that a dam or water can be, see this word is, can be taxed by state, but presidential assent is needed. Again the role of center coming here. तो हमने कैसे बांटा, कुछ आर्टिकल्स थे हमने यूनियन को दे दिए, कुछ स्टेट को दे दिए, कुछ कंकरेंट में दे दिए, लेकिन रेसिड्यूरी पावर हमने पार्लियामेंट के पास रख ली, और जो भी हमने स्टेट्स को पावर दी उस पर भी हमने कुछ सर्टेन रेस्ट्रिक्शंस लगा दिए. Now we come to the distribution part. कि एक बार हमने taxation proposal दे दिया, अब हमारे पास पैसा आने लग गया, तो how would we distributing that thing? So while distribution of any tax is there are three key terms you need to understand. One is levy, one is collection, another is appropriation. So levy means who would be, in whose name the tax would be imposed. Collection means who would be collecting that thing, and appropriation means who would be using it. So these are three different terms. You can understand the conundrum between these things and what is the importance of these things by an example. I give you an example. Say suppose this is a credit card, this is you. If I say this credit card is having money and this credit card belongs to this person, okay, now this credit card, the person says ki you keep this credit card with you and do whatever you want to do with it. Now imagine how happy you would be कि now credit card भी मेरे पास है and money भी है, so I will be using as much I need whenever I'll need. Okay, so this is case one, कि थिंग्स आर क्रेडिटेड इन द नेम ऑफ सेंटर, बट उनको कलेक्ट भी स्टेट कर रहा है एंड अप्रोप्रिएट उसका यूज भी स्टेट कर रहा है. आर यू गेटिंग दैट? दिस इज मोस्ट फिजिबल कंडीशन फॉर एन स्टेट. सो सर्टेन एग्जाम्पल लाइक टैक्स ड्यूटीज आर टैक्स्ड इन सच इन दिस मैनर. Okay, now 268, it's a relatively new added concept. It is a service tax. Now, so understand the service tax by this method. Suppose this credit card is with you. Okay, however, this person says, ki we'll both be using this card. So at times you use, at times I'll use, and we'll be both be using its benefits. Now, this is also a beneficial offer for you, but it is not as beneficial for you as it was in the first case. Okay, now we come to the third case. Okay, now understand ki third case is, suppose this person says to you ki this my credit card, I will be having it with me, so you will tell me ki what things to give and I'll give it to you. Now see, you will be calling this person, it will go, it will bring, and it will be giving you as and when his time would be there. He'll be collecting, he'll be utilizing his only time. So kabhi wo free hua, kabhi wo free nahi hua, aapka kabhi time laga, kabhi time nahi laga. So is case mein you are not free. Okay, so this is the third case, 269th case, in which interstate commerce is there, in which levy and collection is with center. Now see, collection, once collection is done by center, so it is on the prerogative of center as to when he would like to give. Okay, now a state though would be using it, but it has to certainly, there is a restriction on him because collection is done by them. So ultimately the money first goes to them and afterward is given to the center, to the state. Okay, now the third case is, this is the major taxing proposals of our country. This is in which this levy and collection is done by center, say for example income tax, and the usage is done by both center and state. These are major tax, corporation tax, income tax, excise tax, all these things. And this is the main source of revenue for our country. Now, 271 contains surcharges in which levy, collection, appropriation is only by center. Okay, this is the distribution part. Okay, now we come to the non-taxation portions. These are relatively less. Say the proceedings to center of non-tax comes from railways, coinage, banking, PSUs, etc. And to state, what would be there? The articles which are there for there in the state list. So agriculture, forest, and etc. would be the non-tax incomes for a state. Simple. Okay, now we come to another very important concept, that is grant in aid. Basically, grant in aids are grants given to states for their benefits. So grant in aid is self-understanding a statement. Now there are two kind of grants. One is under Article 275. These are statutory grants which are given under the recommendations of Finance Commission. Another are discretionary grants which are under Article 282, and these earlier were given on the recommendation of Planning Commission. And now they are completely under discretion. Now understand, Niti Aayog do not have any role in recommending discretionary grants. Okay, we now come to this statutory grants. See, there are two kinds of statutory grants. One is general, for which are given when a state generally a state needs for say suppose they have to fund any welfare program, they are having any state particularly is ecologically economically very weak, population is very high, human resource development in that is poor, and Finance Commission takes a note of that and recommends center to give certain financial packages, say for example in case of Andhra Pradesh. Okay, similarly there are certain specific statutory grants which are given for the welfare of SCST by the center. Okay, now we come to the discretionary grants. Now as the word discretion comes into Indian administration, it has always brought with it some kind of controversies, and this discretionary grant has not been have been again a source of lot of controversies over a period of time. Okay, its understanding, its definition itself says talks about its loopholes. Okay, let's start it with understand this word. Say this discretionary grant can be given by both center and state. Now this is the loophole or hiccup in it, you need to understand. Okay, not only center but state can do this. Okay, and both way communication can be there. Okay, so center can give to state and state can give to center. Okay, and now it is done under Article 282. Now let me tell you what controversies used to be there. Say for example, any state, say center proposes any scheme. Say for example, Prime Minister Rashtriya Krishi Yojana. So then the center would be forcing the state to make discretionary grants into this so as to make this scheme as a success. So state would be felt, state would be feeling reluctant to do so because this is a center scheme. So this success of this would be making the center government more popular. However, state would be wanting to popularize its own schemes. Okay, so now this becomes highly controversial in cases where center and state have different governments. Okay, one is BJP, one is of Congress. Okay, so then in that case we'll see lot of frictional federalism or competitive federalism. Okay, now we come to the borrowing aspects of center and state. Now this borrowing aspect of center and state nowadays has been immensely in news. I think at least 4 to 5 questions this year came from this concept only in UPSC prelims. Okay, now this concept as in itself comprises a lot of things which we see generally on the economic perspective. Say recently NK Singh committee telling about that debt GDP ratio, then crowding in, crowding out effects, then a private investment concept, Uday bonds. These are all to be understood from this perspective. So whenever you cover it from any of your source material, do pay a special attention to it. Okay, let me tell you the broader outlines of it. Here it says ki center can borrow from on guarantee of Consolidated Fund of India from both in and out of India, so from inside the country and both from abroad. However, state can borrow only in India and has to take prior permission of center when it is taking any loan, if the state has taken any loan on the guarantee of center. Do understand this point very carefully. This question was this concept was twist and was asked in this year's prelims. Okay, okay, now we come to our last concluding portions where we see the tax immunities. Okay, so tax immunities would be there to avoid double taxation. We also see such kind of a concept being introduced between countries where we see double tax avoidance memorandums being signed. So in this, what is done, a constitution says ki any property, not corporation. If you have to understand this word, UPSC at times would put that question in the word of corporations. Okay, corporations are not immune from taxation from state. So tax immunity is given to the properties of center from taxation of state. Also, state is also given a tax immunity from center on both property as well as income. Okay, see, anything earned by state cannot be taxed by center ki this is your income under Income Tax or Corporation Act. So you need to understand that government of Maharashtra, government of Gujarat, government of Haryana cannot be taken as an entity to be taxed under income tax. Okay, however, corporations again are not immune from taxation of center. You're getting that. Now the last, where we give the tacit accent to our federalism concept. So there are certain concepts regarding center in which center cannot be allowed to become hegemonic on states. Such provisions are also taken care in our constitution. Now constitution says ki if center tries to change the definition of agro income or tries to change any duty in which state is interested, or principle of tax devolution is changed, or any surcharge is applied, such a thing can only be done with presidential assent. Now understand, why do you think presidential assent is needed? See, a presidential assent is needed because when anything is sent to president or it is returned by president, it becomes it comes under media attention. So any hasty policy can be avoided in such manner. Now we come to the emergency provision. So in this you need to understand only two things. One is under national emergency, another would be under financial emergency. Now lot of people generally confuse ki under national emergency not much would be done, and under financial emergency lot of changes would be done between center state financial relation, because finance after all it is financial emergency. But the actual situation is a bit reversed. Under national emergency the constitutional provisions can be amended, so even the transfer of finance to states can be stopped. However, in financial emergency no such thing can be done. Only canons regarding financial property can be done. Matlab, they can be asked to cut short their expenditures, their pension or salaries can be cut, or sent certain money bills can be reserved by governor for presidential assent. However, national constitutional provisions can be amended. So guys, that was all for today. Hope you understand this thing and keep learning. Thank you.